Thank you very much. And today's presentation is on radio frequency ablation, destroying liver tumors without surgery. Very briefly, I'll just tell what is liver cancer. Liver cancer is either a cancer within the liver, which arises de novo within the liver, like hepatocellular carcinoma, or it can be a metastasis in the liver, which can come from another source. The malignancy or the cancer is elsewhere, but through the blood it travels to the liver and it settles down there. In this particular slide, the image that you see on the right side, this is a cirrhotic liver. And these kind of livers are very, very prone to develop primary hepatocellular cancers, primary cancers in the liver. And this is a normal liver on the left side, but if this patient did have a malignancy elsewhere in the body, that malignancy has all the chances to spread through the bloodstream and settle down in the liver and multiply there. That is called metastasis in the liver. Now, what is radiofrequency ablation? We can actually deal with these tumors by a process called as radiofrequency ablation. Radiofrequency ablation is a local ablative therapy by a process of thermocoagulation. I'll be discussing that in a little more detail a bit later, but right now I'll only tell you this, that we insert an electrode, which is a very, very special probe, under the guidance of either ultrasound or CT scan, into the liver cancer, and then we connect it to a high frequency generator to a machine. In this process, heat is generated at the tip of this particular electrode, and it cooks the tumor to death. So you are actually heating and cooking the tumor to death. During the course of my talk, I will be dealing with techniques of radiofrequency ablation in the liver. I'll also show some case examples as to when we do radiofrequency ablation, what happens to the liver cancer, and I'll also mention about the strategies as to how we can improve the outcome of radiofrequency ablation. But before I start my talk, I feel it more appropriate to introduce Jacques Arsène de Arsonval, a great physicist. The physicist is on the left side. He is the physicist in his younger days. And as he grew older, he became a physician on the right side. So as you can see, he's the same person in both these images. And he made a very, very startling discovery. The discovery was that when you electrocute a person, when you pass electric current through a person at the frequencies that we know, like 50 hertz of frequency in India, it can be 60 hertz in some other countries, at that frequency there is electrocution. But his discovery was that when you increase the frequency into kilohertz, a very, very high frequency, like 400 to 500 kilohertz, and if that electric current is passed through a patient, the patient doesn't get electrocuted. Why? Because at that high frequency, the electrical current doesn't cause any neuromuscular excitation. So as such, there is no neuromuscular excitation, there is no electrocution. And this is the basic principle which is being used till today in a simple cautery. In the operation theater, the surgeon uses a cautery, and that cautery actually cauterizes tissue using a high frequency current. There is heat generated at the point. The same philosophy or the same logic has been extended to use radiofrequency ablation to destroy larger tumors, to do a volume ablation. The technique has to be slightly modified, and you can actually, instead of a point ablation as in cautery, you get a volume ablation. And for his discovery and his contribution to physics and medicine both, Jacques Arsène de Arsonval was actually awarded the Legion of Honor and the Grand Cross in France, one of the highest rated awards at that time. This is how the radiofrequency ablation will work. When an electric current is passed through a tissue, through the body, and this is an alternating current, as we have it, the electric supply is alternating current. The only thing is it's at a very, very high frequency in 400 to 500 kilohertz. So when the alternating current passes through the body, the ions in the body, they agitate, they move in both the directions, to and fro, and that causes a friction. So there is a frictional heating. and that frictional heating is responsible for heating the tumor to a temperature where it no longer remains viable. Well, this is a plethora of all, a picture of all the machines, radio frequency ablation machines that are available commercially. We are using the machine on extreme right side here now, which is actually the E version, the E series of the Medtronic's machine. Earlier we used this one, we still have this, and we are still using it once in a while. To begin with, we had a machine which is on the extreme left, but we have stopped using that. That's no longer in production. There are many other machines also which are commercially available, and all of them are equally good, but at the same time, they use exactly the same principle, that is passing a very high frequency current through the patient and generating heat at the point of, at the electrode end, which actually destroys the tumor. You can see in this picture the diagrammatic representation as to how the patient is made part of an electrical circuit. If that be the patient, then that's the liver, that's the cancer, and the electrode is inserted into the tumor. And you can see that the other end of this, through a cable, is connected to a high frequency generator. Also, from the generator, there would be earthing pads, because no electric current would pass unless the circuit is complete. So the patient becomes a part of an electrical circuit. The current is flowing from the liver lesion through the generator into the earthing pad and backwards, alternating current. And at this point, heat is generated because of ionic agitation or the frictional heating. You might ask why heat is not generated at the other end. Well, some heat is generated there as well, but you have these grounding pads and two of them over a larger surface area. So the same heat is distributed over a much larger area, which is not enough to cause any problems. RF ablation causes tissue necrosis by heat, as I mentioned, and experimental studies have shown that at 49 degrees Celsius, the cell death occurs within a few minutes. At 60 degrees Celsius, there is immediate cell death, and if it's 100 degrees or more than 100 degrees, the cells boil, the tissue will start boiling, and that is not what we want to happen. And gas vapors release and there is tissue charring, because at those high temperatures, when everything becomes dry, the current will not flow actually. And then the whole process will come to a standstill. So our aim should not be to increase the temperature to beyond 80, 90 or 100 degrees. It should be to contain it between 60 to 70 degrees. Radio frequency ablation in the liver is basically, as I said in the beginning of my talk, you can have a primary liver cancer, which is the hepatocellular carcinoma, or you can have secondary liver cancers, which are metastatic liver cancers. So actually, the hepatocellular carcinoma, patients who are poor surgical candidates and surgery can't be done because of cirrhosis or because of previous surgery, they are suitable for radio frequency ablation. The technique is also used to bridge, as a bridge to liver transplantation, excuse me, and for liver metastasis, most often they are from the colorectal primaries, because from colon and rectum, the blood supply directly goes into the liver. It can be other primaries as well. And when the cancer has gone and settled in the liver, we can actually destroy these cancers also by radio frequency ablation. And sometimes these colorectal metastases are also not suitable for surgical resection, and they can be treated with radio frequency ablation. Of course, we have to keep in mind one fact, that the cancer hasn't spread to other parts of the body, because in that situation, it's no longer going to be a curative option, it's going to be only palliative. But these days, actually, even if the cancer has spread to other parts of the body and the decision is to destroy the liver cancer, we can still go ahead and do it, but it has to be in combination with some form of systemic treatment, which will be some form of a combination chemotherapy. There is a checklist. We always need to check that everything is fine with the patient before we proceed with the radio frequency ablation. So we must have the coagulation parameters in order. We also try to do the baseline markers like alpha fetoprotein in liver, primary liver cancers, and CEA or anything else that is relevant to a particular primary which has spread to the liver. Most important of all is a multidisciplinary consultation. A patient should be discussed in a multi-speciality clinic, with all specialists and all stakeholders participating, and the best decision which is taken there is in the best interest of the patient, and we have to actually abide by that. because there can be more than one ways of treating the patient. And we must find out which is the best option in a particular situation. So it is like a personalized treatment. Also, it is important that the patient is actually, he undergoes a pre-anesthetic check, because we do these procedures under conscious sedation, or actually we do these procedures under monitored anesthesia. So the anesthesia team is there to assist me, to assist us during the process, and a prior examination of the patient to rule out any problems which may come up at that time has to be done. And again, very, very important is a proper informed consent from the patient, communication with the patient, and planning of the entire procedure. So communication with the patient before you do the procedure, communication with the patient after you do the procedure is very, very critical. Yeah, this is actually, it is a bit of a small surgical procedure, except that you don't cut open the patient, but you just insert a needle. But you can see in the image here that there is a whole team here, and the anesthesia colleagues are there to help you, to help with the procedure. A few examples now. Excuse me. You can see on this image on the left side that this is a CT scan in the arterial phase, and you see a small lesion in the liver which is enhancing in the arterial phase. It did show washout in the delayed phase and in the venous, portal venous phase, and so this is a hepatocellular carcinoma. These days you don't need to biopsy them to prove that they're hepatocellular carcinomas. These imaging findings are good enough to confirm that this is hepatocellular carcinoma. And these are also in the guideline, this particular imaging and confirmation on imaging by the American Association for Study of Liver Disease and many other groups. We went ahead and ablated this lesion. It was a slightly difficult approach because one had to actually go from the caudal side to the cranial side. You don't want to make an entry transpleural into this. It's close to the diaphragm. As you can see here, that's the electrode. And when we connected it to the machine and ablated, the next day we did a CT scan. And in the CT scan, in the same arterial phase also, you see that the whole area is destroyed. That all that black area has no vascularity. There is hardly any blood flowing there. And this lesion has been completely eliminated. It's always important to actually destroy a little bit of an area around the lesion, because you don't want to leave any cancer cells in the vicinity of the lesion. So here is a hepatocellular cancer, very small one, and which has been ablated and destroyed completely. Another patient, a 47-year-old male who was hepatitis C positive, and you can see that in the arterial phase on this top image, there is an enhancing lesion in the liver. And this again needed a caudocranial approach. It wasn't a straight approach. We usually do our procedures under CT guidance. And in this lesion, we inserted the electrode, connected it to the machine, we ablated it. After ablation, you can see that there is a larger area, again in the arterial phase, as you can see, which doesn't show any vascularity. You might wonder, why is there a white rim around it? Well, immediately after the procedure, within 24 to 48 to 72 hours, you will see some periablational enhancement because of inflammatory response. So that is not the tumor, but that is actually periablational enhancement, inflammation. If you follow up this cancer over a period of time, it will shrink gradually. In this particular case, after 3 months, we repeated the CT scan, and you can see the size has shrunk. And gradually, it will just remain a scar, and it will disappear. So that is how the evolution of the liver cancer happens after you have treated it with radiofrequency ablation. Sometimes there are bigger tumors, larger tumors, and we have a facility to actually insert more than one electrode at the same time in the same tumor and then burn it and destroy it. And as you can see here, we have inserted three electrodes, and all three of them are active, but only one will be transmitting the current. As you can see right now, this is the electrode which is transmitting the current. When the resistance increases on the path of this particular circuit, it will switch to another. And so it has switched, as you have seen. And so that is called the switching electrode. And this technology is very useful in treating with larger cancers. There are changing concepts in cancer care today. Cancer is no longer a death warrant. And actually, there are current concepts in cancer care which have made it into a transformed cancers into a chronic disease. And many cancer patients live on for 10 years, 20 years, and even beyond. And so basically, you have to treat the cancer multiple times. Advances in therapy have rendered cancer to behave like a chronic disease. You may have had patients or you may have known patients who are undergoing a particular line of chemotherapy, then the cancer comes back, a second line of chemotherapy, then some radiation, then some surgery, then again some targeted therapies, and so on. So cancer is being treated multiple times over a very prolonged period. And actually, the radiofrequency ablation fits into this very well, because this is also one modality or one strategy which can be used whenever it's appropriate. This is an example. A patient of cancer breast way back in 2004, and the patient developed metastasis in the liver in 2009. The image top left, you can see it's a fatty liver, and the metastasis is standing out. That is, the cancer from the breast has spread to the liver. It was our tumor board decision that we should ablate it because a local treatment was considered necessary at that time. We ablated this lesion. And after ablation, you can see that there is no vascularity. The cancer cells or the cancer in that area has been killed. And this ablation area, as we call it, or the coagulation area, is larger than the original tumor. That is what we want. A PET CT was also done. And the PET CT showed that there is no metabolic activity in that area. So even normal metabolic activity wasn't there. As you can see, the rest of the liver shows some metabolic activity, but not there because there is no liver tissue there. It's all dead tissue there. A few months down the line, another PET CT was done, and you can see that the patient has metabolically very active liver, except that part. So that part is dead. The rest is very, very metabolically active, and the cancer had involved, in fact, every part of the liver at that time. That's why it's so metabolically active. Patient was subjected to chemotherapy. Luckily, the patient responded to this chemotherapy, and all this metabolic activity disappeared, as you can see in this new image. But unfortunately, there was yet another lesion here. That small one, which is metabolically active. We went ahead and ablated that also. The point I'm trying to drive home is that cancer can be treated multiple times. In this case, multiple lines of chemotherapy, cancer coming back, you being sequentially more than one ablation of liver cancer. And so the cancer is being treated more and more like a chronic disease, just like diabetes or hypertension. In radiofrequency ablation, we have to pay attention very carefully to patient selection. And as far as patient selection is concerned, it's important to evaluate the entire disease burden. It's not that you just see a lesion in the liver and you go and ablate. You must know how much is the disease outside the liver, how much is the disease within the liver. Is it okay to do RF ablation alone, or you need some more therapies? It has to be a multidisciplinary discussion. We always have that. You also have to think of the alternatives, because there can be more than one ways of dealing with a cancer or dealing with a cancer in the liver. Sequencing of treatment is also equally important. Counseling of the patient and the relatives, etc., etc. So actually, it is a process. The whole thing is a process which is collectively discussed by the clinicians and the patient. We take the patient into confidence, and very often we make the patient as a part of the decision-making process, because there are multiple options, and we need to give the patient all the options with the pros and cons of each and every option, and then you arrive at a decision. But most important of all is this multidisciplinary discussion. You have to optimize the strategies for the radiofrequency ablation. And in order to optimize to get the best outcomes, the aim of your strategy should be that you want to prevent or minimize the complications. At the same time, very important, you have to maintain harmony with your colleagues. I'm repeating again and again the fact that it has to be a multidisciplinary discussion or a consultation. There can be more than one way of treating the liver cancer. It can be something like SBRT, radiation, resection, but sometimes everything is not equally good, so that comes through a discussion. There should not be any confrontation with the colleagues. We don't want a situation like this, where you know the different clinicians are actually trying to take the patient away to treat by one particular modality. No, there is no place for confrontation. So it has to be a discussion in a multi-speciality clinic where all the facts are discussed, and then one gets to know what is the best option in a given situation. Once that decision has been reached, we implement that, and absolutely there is no case for any confrontation. So this is actually very, very important to maintain harmony with colleagues. Also, there is a case to combine multiple treatments because there is a synergistic effect. If you combine strategies, the results are better. And one has to actually carefully choose what are these strategies, what are the treatment modalities which can be combined. Radiofrequency ablation can be combined with transarterial chemoembolization. Transarterial chemoembolization is yet another treatment in which you insert a catheter into the liver, into the lesion, and inject with chemotherapeutic drugs along with embolization to shrink the larger tumor. And if something is left behind, if it's smaller, then you can do the RF ablation. And very often with surgery as well. After taste, transarterial chemoembolization, if surgery is possible, that can also be done. And if surgery is not possible upfront, taste can be done, followed by radiofrequency ablation. So these are all modalities, and we need to use the most judicious combination or permutation and combination of these modalities. Systemic chemotherapy always helps, particularly in metastatic disease, to the liver, and the results are always better. Patient will not need just one RF ablation, but patient will need probably multiple types of treatment. Stereotactic body radiotherapy is also coming in, and it has coming for the liver as well, where you do not actually puncture the liver, but you do radiation, highly focused and very strong radiation at the point of the liver disease. Combining radiofrequency ablation with liposomal doxorubicin, you inject liposomal doxorubicin, these are heat sensitive and they will actually disintegrate wherever there is heat. So when you are destroying the tumor by heating, these liposomes will actually disintegrate there, and there will be a chemotherapeutic dose also locally delivered at that point. So the point I'm trying to make is that there is a sense in combining the strategies, in combining multiple modalities to treat liver cancers, be it hepatocellular carcinoma or be it metastatic liver disease. Well, the radiofrequency ablation may have its own share of some complications, and we have to be aware of those complications. The complications can be collateral thermal injuries to bowel, biliary tree, and diaphragm. Whenever these structures are in close proximity to your electrode, the heat can traverse to the bowel, to the biliary tree, or to the diaphragm and cause some injury. Also, there can be a direct trauma due to the electrode. The electrode is usually a 16 or 17 gauge needle, and you can directly puncture a vessel. And so one has to be a little careful. If you're going transpleural, you can cause a pneumothorax, you can cause hemorrhage if you're puncturing a big vessel, etc. And sometimes within the liver, there are locations which are very, very challenging for the interventional radiologist to approach, not only just to approach, but to get a satisfactory ablation. And if there is a proximity of less than 5 millimeters to one of the critical structures, you have to be a little careful and you have to take a little extra precautions. As far as a large vessel is concerned, close proximity to a vessel means that the vessel is actually taking away the heat, what is called as the heat sink effect. So when you are trying to heat the tumor in close proximity to a vessel, the vessel acts like a cooling coil. It is like a flow mediated cooling. And so it keeps on cooling, and you are never able to achieve the kind of temperature that you want to achieve to destroy the tumor. In addition to that, if very close to the lesion in the liver, there is another structure like the diaphragm, the heart, the lung, gallbladder, the kidney on the right side, etc., or gastrointestinal tract, inadvertent or unintended injury, heat injury to these structures is possible. We have to deal with this situation very carefully. In this particular example in the liver, you can see that this particular lesion on the in the left lobe is very close to the heart. this lesion is so close to the stomach that you can cause actually injury to the stomach and there can be even a perforation. This lesion is so close to the hepatic vein, and the hepatic vein, the blood flow through the hepatic vein will always cause cooling of this area, and your heat will not be enough to probably destroy. The chances of a residue are far more. And that lesion is so close to the diaphragm that you can actually burn a little bit of the diaphragm. This will be very, very close to the kidney, and we have to actually protect the kidney. Close to the gallbladder, we don't want injury to the gallbladder. Also to the cystic duct, to the bile duct, etc., etc. So we have to take enough precautions, you know, when we are dealing with these cases. These are difficult, challenging cases. Once we are aware that we are dealing with a critical structure very close to the point of ablation, we usually try and isolate that particular organ at risk by injecting dextrose. We inject dextrose. This is called hydrodissection. So we isolate the organ at risk by injecting dextrose between that organ and the point of ablation. Dextrose creates an insulating envelope, and the heat will have to traverse that film of dextrose to reach to the organ, and it does provide protection. It also actually will prevent inadvertent thermal injury to any adjacent structures. I'll be dealing with a few examples here. As you can see here, that there is a lesion very close to the surface of the liver here, and the colon is right next to that. That's the colon. If you want to destroy that directly by radiofrequency ablation, the colon will definitely have a perforation. We created artificial ascites, moved the colon away, and then we ablated. And after ablation, as you can see, the lesion is ablated right till the capsule. The patient did not have any perforation. So the process of hydrodissection, the process of isolating the organs at risk by injecting dextrose, is something which has to be implemented wherever you're dealing with a situation where there is a chance of collateral injury to adjacent organs. Another case here, the lesion was not seen clearly here, but was very, very close to the bowel loops, the duodenum. We injected dextrose, which was opacified with contrast so that it delineates better, and we moved the bowel away, and then we ablated this particular lesion without any injuries to the bowel loops. Another lesion, as you can see, this was a metastatic deposit. By location, you can make out that this is very close to the portal vein and the gallbladder. To ablate this means that the effect of ablation will not be as good, because the portal vein is causing what is known as the heat sink effect. At the same time, some possibility of thermal injury to the gallbladder. We injected dextrose, which was opacified with contrast, and as you can see, the dextrose is around the portal vein, not inside. What is dark is the portal vein, and what is outside is the lining of the portal vein with the fluid, with the dextrose that we have injected. You can also see the dextrose, opacified dextrose, outlining the gallbladder. The gallbladder, you can see the outline of the gallbladder by the dextrose, and that's the portal vein opacified outside the portal vein. That's the portal vein, and that's the electrode. We ablated this lesion, and this is the ablation, as you can see here. So right up to the portal vein, that's the portal vein. You can ablate these lesions right up to the blood vessel if you have slightly separated the blood vessel so that the heat sink effect is not there. Sometimes a lesion can be very, very close to the stomach. This is dangerously close to the gastric wall. That's the stomach. We actually injected, again, dextrose, opacified dextrose here. You can see the stomach has been pushed away. And after this, we could actually satisfactorily ablate this liver lesion. So hydrodissection does help. That's the lesion in the liver, which we had to separate out from the stomach and then do the RF ablation. Some patients, if the ablation volume is large, they'll have some post-ablation syndrome. And in this syndrome, which is very, very similar to tumor lysis syndrome, there is mild fever, nausea, vomiting, malaise, fatigue after the procedure, very much like a viral fever. It is usually self-limiting, but what actually helps is hydration of the patient. So adequate hydration of the patient after the procedure is recommended. There has been a study which is looking at here, actually, the disease-free survival, RFA versus surgical resection in small hepatocellular carcinomas. Small means less than 3 centimeter, up to 3 centimeter. And as you can see, that the results are more or less similar. So now there is enough evidence that for small HCC, radio frequency ablation, can become a first line therapy. And in most cases where surgery is not possible, it is already the first line therapy. There is also an ongoing study. The results should be out anytime. Radio frequency ablation versus stereotactic radiotherapy in colorectal liver metastasis. This study is being conducted at the RS University Hospital in Denmark, and the primary endpoint is local progression-free survival. The results were expected in December 2015, but to my knowledge, not yet published. Radio frequency ablation is a technique which is not only specific to the liver. It can be used to treat and destroy cancers in other parts of the body like lung, kidney, bone, and others. But by and large, the majority of radio frequency ablations are performed in the liver. At our institute, 80% of radio frequency ablations are performed in the liver, either for primary hepatocellular carcinoma or for metastatic liver disease. Most of the time, it is for primary hepatocellular carcinoma. So to conclude, I would say that radio frequency ablation is an accepted way of treating both primary and secondary liver tumors, and it is a modality which is less invasive, which is a loco-regional treatment for liver cancers, and is pretty useful. Thank you very much. So, if there are questions, I'll be happy to answer the questions. I think I can take the questions. Well, the question is, what is the cost of radio frequency ablation and is it covered under insurance? Well, as far as India is concerned, everybody takes a private insurance, or those who can afford take a private insurance, and most of the time it is covered under the insurance. Also, the cost in India is approximately 1,30,000. So it is 130,000 Indian rupees. That is the cost in India. Is there another question?
Hello?
Yes?
Yes. So I can read out the questions for you and you can give the answers.
Oh, yes, certainly. But I should be able to read them here. Just a second. Yes.
Yes.
Okay, the question is, why do you think RFA technique is more widely used to treat liver cancer and not cancer of other organs? Okay, now the liver is most approachable to with a needle under a CT or ultrasound guidance. That is one. And basically, we can use radio frequency ablation to treat only small cancer. So long as the size is up to about 3 centimeters, you get a curative result. But if it goes beyond 3 centimeters, there is a chance of a recurrence. In the liver, you get to identify these cancers quite early and you can treat them while they are still small. को बुलाओ बैठे हो। I think there are a few questions and I'll be reading them one by one. For some reason, I'm not getting to read them clearly. So just give me a little time. Let me see the questions. Well, one question here is RFA done for metastatic neuroendocrine tumors? Yes, RFA can be done for metastatic neuroendocrine tumors, particularly in situations where there is a functional problem as well, where the neuroendocrine tumors are functional, it's spread in the liver in multiple places, you can do RF ablation to destroy those tumors and the treatment is actually quite successful. What is the cost of RFA and is it covered under insurance? This I have already answered. Yes, it is covered under insurance in India, but if you have a specific insurance cover from an insurance company, you should actually ask the insurance company whether they are covering RFA. In the routine course, I think it is covered, and the cost, as I mentioned earlier, is 130,000. What is the cost of setting up RFA? The cost of setting up RFA is the cost of the machine and the cost of the electrodes. So depending on which particular commercially available radio frequency machine you are buying, the cost of setting up can be anything between 25 to 40 lakhs of Indian rupees, between 25 to 40 lakhs of Indian rupees. And the cost of each electrode will vary from vendor to vendor. It can be anything from 15,000 to about 50,000 rupees. The question is, during the procedure, the patient is under local anesthesia. Well, as I mentioned in the course of my talk, the patient is under controlled anesthesia, what used to be called as conscious sedation. So we always have the anesthesia team. They will sedate the patient. But at the same time, at the point of entry, we always give a local anesthetic infiltration. The question has come up again, I think, why you think RFA technique is more widely used to treat liver cancer and not cancer of other organs? Liver is a very, very peculiar problem. In the liver, we don't only have to look at the surgical option, but we have to keep in mind that it is a functional organ. So liver is a functional organ, and for this to function clearly, we have to be sure that we don't interfere with the function. So, for example, if a kidney is having cancer, the kidney can be removed. The entire kidney can be removed or it can be partially removed. As far as the liver is concerned, you can only remove to a particular point, but not beyond that. So if there is a partial hepatectomy which has been done, right or left lobectomy, hepatectomy has been done, then if a cancer comes up in the remaining liver, if you keep doing surgeries, maybe you'll be interfering with the liver function. Liver function is very, very critical to life. That is why minimally invasive procedures which are actually not destroying a lot of liver beyond, and the functional restoration is there of the liver, that's why the reason why RF ablation is used more and more in the liver. Well, as far as brain is concerned, no, we cannot do RF ablation in brain. I haven't heard people doing RF ablation in the brain. But as far as prostate is concerned, yes, in the prostate it can be used. In the prostate, HIFU is already being used and also RF ablation can be used. But by and large, the standard of care in prostate is either surgery or radiotherapy. Then there is a question here. I'm just trying to get some help to get the questions. I'm not able to see the questions. They're all hiding here. How do I get these questions? The questions, I'm not able to see clearly. Okay, I think the box has now opened up, so I'll go up again one by one, dealing with the questions, and basically I'll go by I'll take the questions. This question is from Aditi Nigam. How long would a patient be hospitalized for radio frequency ablation? Also, is this the same principle behind RFA done for cardiac arrhythmia as in PSVT? My answer is that for radio frequency ablation, the patient is usually admitted for one night. The day we do the procedure, well, actually you can do a daytime procedure and discharge the patient in the evening, but as a standard practice at my institute, we keep the patient for that day. And sometimes the patient is actually admitted the previous night of the RF ablation because we need to do all the pre-anesthetic checks and tests, and in that situation it becomes two nights. So it is actually either one or two nights admission for radio frequency ablation at our institute. The principle is exactly the same as it is used in cardiac arrhythmias. The principle is no different, except that the equipment is slightly different, because in cardiac arrhythmias, you're looking at a very, very fine, very point ablation. In radio frequency ablation in the liver or in cancers elsewhere, we are looking at a volume ablation. We want to increase the area of tumor destruction or area of ablation as much as possible to cover the entire tumor. And that is actually one of the limitations of RF ablation, that you cannot destroy more than 5 centimeters of volume in the diameter. And if a cancer is more than 5 centimeters, you will always leave behind a residue, what we will call an R1 ablation. But cancers up to 3 centimeters can now be conveniently destroyed by radio frequency ablation, and as of now there is technology which is evolving, which is improving, only to provide you with larger and larger volume ablations. The next question is by Dr. Sarita Srivastava, and the question is, sir, what is the procedure for isolation with dextrose? Is there any chance for the dextrose solution to act as heat sink? Well, good question. Dextrose. We use dextrose because dextrose does not conduct electricity. Never ever use saline. Saline conducts electricity. So you are using the patient as an electrical circuit. If you happen to inject saline, the current will start flowing that way. And your desired result of keeping the heat away from the target, non-target organ or the organ at risk will be defeated. Dextrose is actually a heat sink, and that's how we are using it. Because we want the dextrose to absorb the heat and not let it go to the organ which is at risk. If the gallbladder is very close to where you are ablating, and if you have been able to inject a little bit of dextrose between the gallbladder and the liver parenchyma, the gallbladder will be protected because the heat will not be able to travel up to the gallbladder. The heat will either the dextrose will act as an insulator, as well as, you know, this will be a buffer between the gallbladder and the lesion which is being ablated. And so mechanically also you are separating the gallbladder away from the lesion. In fact, it applies more aptly to the bowel, which can be easily moved. So if there is a bowel loop which is close to the point of ablation, you can inject dextrose and move it away. So you have created a distance, and the heat cannot travel that distance, plus there is the barrier of the dextrose, which is actually a non-conductor of electricity. It does conduct heat to some extent, but then at the same time the distance has been increased and it will absorb that heat, and the collateral thermal injury to the bowel loop or any other organ at risk will not happen. We also inject dextrose between the kidney and a lesion in the right lobe of the liver, which is dangerously close to the upper pole of the kidney. And once you have done that, the kidney will be prevented from suffering any thermal damage. Another question is from Dr. Kiran Bhagat. And the question is, once an ablation is done, what is recurrence of tumor in other parts of the liver in your experience? Well, yes, it depends on the biology of the disease. Talking of hepatocellular carcinomas, now most of the time these hepatocellular carcinomas occur in a cirrhotic liver or in a pre-diseased liver. So we are actually dealing with a situation where there is a malignancy within an overall malignancy producing environment. The liver itself is actually very prone to develop these cancers. So the chances of the liver developing another hepatocellular carcinoma in another part of the liver is pretty high. In our experience, we do see lesions coming up again within 6 months to 1 year or even earlier, and we go ahead and destroy that additional lesion also. And that is why in a liver which is having hepatocellular carcinoma, in a cirrhotic liver, the definitive treatment is liver transplant. But as the RF ablation is working as a bridge to the liver transplant, because liver transplant is not feasible or possible very quickly, and so while you are planned for the liver transplant, you get the donor, RF ablation can keep the patient healthy till that time. So you have to be prepared to destroy liver tumor sequentially, maybe multiple times in a case of a hepatocellular carcinoma. In a case of fibrolamellar hepatocellular carcinoma, I have done radio frequency ablation 12 times. That's a record. That's the maximum I have done in one single patient over a period of 5 years. As far as recurrence for metastatic liver cancers is concerned, it again depends on the biology of the cancer. And the fact is that once metastasis to the liver has happened from, say, either a primary in the breast or a primary elsewhere, it has happened obviously through the systemic circulation, so it is a systemic spread. And in these situations, unless a systemic treatment is done, you are actually likely to get disease elsewhere in the liver as well as in other parts of the body like the lung, etc. So this all depends on the biology of the disease, how aggressive the disease has been, what is the time interval, etc., etc. And that is why I emphasized on the joint approach to deal with these kinds of situations, and not a standalone RF ablation is not actually the finality of the treatment, but it is just one step in the overall management of such patients. Another question is from Kim. I think he's already left. The question is, will ablation replace surgery in otherwise normal candidates with HCC? I mean, will it totally replace surgery someday? Well, the answer to this question is yes. If the cancer is small, and in the liver, it's a primary hepatocellular carcinoma, it's less than 3 centimeters, the results are so good now that the surgeons also have started recommending or doing radiofrequency ablation as the first line treatment. And this is very, very soon it's going to come in the standard of practice. So small liver cancers can be dealt with radiofrequency ablation, where the chances of recurrence are the same as with a surgical removal of that cancer. And over a period of time, there are many studies which are actually now which are having the results, and the conclusions in most of these studies is that radiofrequency ablation for small tumors is as effective as surgical resection of these tumors, particularly in hepatocellular carcinomas. Another question is, can radiofrequency ablation be used in lesions other than the tumor? Well, radiofrequency ablation is being used for tumors in the liver, in the kidney, in the bone, in many other situations, in the lung. Using radiofrequency ablation to destroy another benign tumor, yes, it is possible theoretically, but such tumors can be dealt with simple surgery as well. And there isn't a lot of literature supporting the use of radiofrequency ablation in non-cancerous situations, except in one, where it is the number one modality today, and that is an osteoid osteoma of the bone. which is so painful that you can't treat the pain. It comes back again and again at night, only responds to aspirin, high doses of aspirin, and if you do radiofrequency ablation, the pain disappears forever. We have a very good experience of all this, and this is today, as a standard of care, the first line treatment. Radiofrequency ablation is the first line treatment to destroy osteoid osteomas. Another question is from Pavitra Nilkar. During the procedure, the patient is under local anesthesia. My answer is, yes, we do give local anesthesia, but in addition, there is also controlled anesthesia or conscious sedation. So the patient is actually sedated and quite deeply so, but sometimes we want the patient to respond to commands. So the anesthesia team, the colleagues are always there to help us. I want to tell the patient, take a deep breath in or breathe out, etc., etc. And in that situation, the patient, if the patient is able to comply with my instructions, it is good for me. So that's why it is a controlled anesthesia. Control the pain, but don't put the patient to such deep sleep that you have no control over his respiration or the other parameters. Another question is from Rajesh Burnwal, and the question is, why do you think RFA technique is more widely used to treat liver cancer and not cancer of other organs? I think I have already answered this. It has been used extensively in the liver, but as I said, it has also been used in the kidney, in the lung, in the bone, etc., etc., in the pancreas. In other organs, there is always another way of treating those cancers. In fact, RF ablation is also being used in the breast at MD Anderson Cancer Center as a first-line modality for small cancers in very old women who are not fit for surgery. So it can be used in other situations also, but the maximum actually accumulated experience is in liver. Another question from Rajesh Burnwal, what are the training opportunities available for learning this technique in India? Well, there are no organized training programs for radiofrequency ablation, but radiofrequency ablation is being carried out in many centers now, and one can tie up with those centers to be attached to those centers or hospitals for a few weeks to see the procedure and to learn the procedure. But so far, there is no organized training program to learn the procedure. Another question, Rajesh Burnwal. Does this process interfere with cancer medication that a patient might be having before getting this treatment? Well, in a way, no. If I have a simple answer and short answer is no. In fact, any other treatment that the patient is receiving has a synergistic effect. So it adds up to the effect of the radiofrequency ablation and the results are even better. Once in a while, it may so happen that if the patient is on some treatment, for example, sorafenib, etc., which is for liver cancers, you may have to stop that medicine because it is more prone to develop bleeding during the procedure. So except very, very few situations, most of the time, any other treatment which is combined with the treatment of radiofrequency ablation is only going to be helpful. This question I've already answered earlier. What is the cost in setting up radiofrequency ablation therapy? Well, the cost is the cost of the machine and the cost of the electrodes. The cost of machines varies widely and also on your negotiation skills with the vendor. And but it would be anything between 25 to 50 lakhs of rupees in terms of Indian rupees, and the cost of each electrode will be anything between 15,000 rupees to about 50,000 rupees. This question also I answered, can we do brain surgery? Can we do for brain and small prostate? No brain. I don't think we treat brain with radiofrequency ablation, not to my knowledge. Prostate, yes, but there are other ways to treat prostate. What is the maximum diameter of the electrode? Well, the electrodes come either in gauge, we measure them in gauge, so they are actually thick needles. It is either 17 gauge or 16 gauge, which is slightly thicker, or 15 gauge, which is even thicker. So it is actually a quite a thick needle. It is not bigger than 15 gauge. So 15 gauge is probably the biggest. The question is, what is the cost of radio frequency ablation and is it covered under insurance? I mentioned the cost of one procedure at our institute, it may be different in other institutions, is approximately 1,30,000 rupees with one night admission in the hospital, including the charges for that admission. It's covered by insurance. Most of the insurance companies have actually reimbursed to the patient, and in some cases it has been even absolutely a cashless coverage at our institution. Is RFA done for metastatic neuroendocrine tumor? I have already answered this question. Yes, particularly the neuroendocrine tumor is functional and there is great relief, so it's a therapeutic procedure to take care of the functional problems associated with neuroendocrine tumors, like the flushing, diarrhea, etc. So all that gets controlled. Can we delist a patient from liver treatment list having liver metastasis, or is it just a debulking modality to downstage a tumor? The question is by Yogendra Arya, and actually speaking, it all depends on the size of the initial tumor or the size of the index tumor. If the size of the initial tumor is 3 centimeters, it is a curative option. You can actually eliminate the tumor altogether. But if the patient is having multiple tumors and bigger than 3 centimeters, and in that case it doesn't remain a curative modality, but it is only a palliative setting. And sometimes it is downstaging the tumor so that, you know, it can become surgically resectable. And the, very often it's the other way around. You do a taste to downstage a tumor and then you do the RF ablation or surgery.